when we saw some of the most recent numbers, specifically out of LA County. Two deaths being reported per hour. We're talking about ICUs that are basically full. The ripple effect of that, Sanjay, can't be underscored enough.
No, I mean, you're running into a situation where you just don't have beds. I mean, at the beginning of this, when you're looking at the Northeast, if you had a situation where there weren't enough beds, you could at least adapt a regional structure to move patients to different parts of the region or even different parts of the country. That's difficult when every place that you might send patients is also struggling with resources, beds, manpower, whatever it might be. So, you know, you have to sort of think about this idea that what are the escape hatches here? When they talk about the fact that they don't have really any ICU beds in some of these communities, what does that mean exactly? If someone needs ICU care, they're going to have to triage. They're going to have to make some tough decisions. I mean, they've been anticipating this, and they're going to do a great job trying to find the extra square footage and trying to take care of these patients. But it's a real challenge and, you know, a situation that we did not have to be in right now.
All right, Sanjay, you are at Grady Memorial Hospital in Atlanta along with Dr. Valerie Montgomery Rice. You are both receiving the vaccine now. I'll let you take it away and walk us through this process.
Yep, I am here with my old friend, Valerie Montgomery Rice, the president and dean of the Morehouse School of Medicine. I just want to say something before we start, because, you know, I'm sort of in an interesting position today, right? I work here as a healthcare worker, therefore I'm getting the vaccine. Healthcare workers are more at risk. I've also, you know, been covering the story so intensely for a year. I've talked to the people who make these vaccines. I've talked to the FDA commissioner. I've talked to the data scientists. I am comfortable getting this vaccine. And yet there are so many people who are still not comfortable. And I was surprised, Dr. Rice, that even at here at Grady, about a third of people, healthcare workers, say they would get it. A third say they need more information. And a third say they would not get it. That kind of surprised me. So a couple questions. First of all, you're totally comfortable getting this vaccine.
Totally comfortable. Totally comfortable.
Well, how have you approached this decision for yourself?
I mean, for me personally, you know, as a clinician scientist, I have followed all the data. I listened in at the ACIP. I'm on one of the NIH panels, so I've had the opportunity to look at the phase 0, phase 1, phase 2. But like you, I've gotten a lot of calls from people, right? So over the last couple of weeks, 3 of my mentees called me who are on the front line. I don't know if I'm going to take this vaccine. I said, really? We're scientists. Okay, so let's go through the data. Went through the data with them. And then even just yesterday, one of my staff people came in to me. We were in the office and she says, Dr. Rice, my husband is on the front line and he works in one of the technical areas, but he's on the front line. He says, in a hospital, he's concerned about taking it. And I said, went through the data with her and said, you know, this is probably one of the most important steps that we can make to mitigate the virus and do the health preventive measures that we've been doing.
Well, right? Was there something about the data that stuck out to you specifically mm-hmm. for Black Americans?
You know, when I looked at the Pfizer data, okay, about 3,900 Blacks, right, who were in there, when you looked at the ones who got the vaccine, 1,900 or so, very effective, even more so effective than the other demographics. And then the early data that I looked at from Moderna yesterday, of the Blacks who were in the vaccine treatment arm, 100% effective. And so it does show that it is not, we're not seeing a distinction that is negative based on race or ethnicity, age, or even obesity. So that's very positive to me.
Do you think this issue of vaccine hesitancy, especially among Black Americans, is addressable? Or, I mean, is this going to change, do you think?
I think it is addressable. We're already seeing it. Back in August, when we first started the Black Coalition Against COVID-19, the Four Black Historical Medical Schools, the NMA, the National Urban League, we've been doing these town halls. In fact, we did one last night, about 30,000 or 40,000 people on there. And we are starting to see a difference in the number of people saying that they would continue to think about it, but now moving up from vaccine hesitancy to vaccine acceptance. And then the Kaiser Family Foundation, initially in August, 60% of people said they wouldn't. it was down to 42% or 45%. So we're making some progress, but it's about communication, 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 and demonstrating and modeling. So that's what we are kind of here for today, right?
Absolutely. And I, again, I'll say it. I've been following this for a year from the beginnings of this vaccine. I am totally comfortable taking it. I feel it's important to say. You are comfortable taking it. There is a reason why people are I don't want to minimize people's hesitations,
exactly.
Especially when it comes to Black Americans.
Right.
The history of medical science and medical experimentation, I think a word I can use, has really fostered some of this, right?
Yeah, so if we went back and people can name the Mississippi appendectomy studies, people can name, you know, the Tuskegee, the people can name even some of the modern day things where we're hearing that women in Georgia are being having hysterectomies unnecessarily. But what we know that's different now, you all, is that there are Black scientists in the room where decisions are being made. There are Black scientists who are in the development of the vaccine. There are Black scientists who are on the FDA advisory panel. There are Black scientists on the ACIP. There are Black scientists on the CDC advisory boards. And then there are people like me who are looking at the data, helping to interpret it, working with the National Academy, giving our recommendations of the allocation. So we're in the rooms where it's happening. And so we clearly are not going to go against ourselves, right? Because we understand how critical this is for Black America and Latinx America, who has been disproportionately impacted by the virus. I would not actually recommend anything if I did not believe it was safe.
All right.
All right.
Your voice is so important. You ready to do this?
We're ready.
All right.
Yeah. Okay.
Mary Catherine's going to come in here and do the jabs. Mary Catherine, thank you, I think, in advance. While we're getting ready, I should tell you as well, Dr. Rice is one of only three Black mother daughters, Harvard Medical School, and your daughter just graduated.
Right.
Now a vascular surgery resident.
Yeah, she is a vascular surgery resident at UPenn. Jane Raven giving you a shout out. So, yeah.
Maybe
so
she's watching,
we probably embarrassed her now.
Right.
Since you won't forgive me for that. But, so I'm going to sit down.
Now, we are both going to get this shot in our left arm.
Yeah.
Because we are right-handed. So
that's
they do
right.
The non-dominant arm.
My friends know I'm afraid of needles.
Is that right?
Yeah, I don't like needles. I don't like needles.
You're a doctor. You're
right here.
Yeah. I am a doctor. I'm a surgeon, too. That's the sad thing.
You prescribe a lot of needles and scalpels, but you don't like getting them
yourself. It's different when you're driving the needle.
Right.
It's a lot different when you're driving the needle.
All right.
I shall relax.
Big moment. I got to just say it.
Yeah.
Ready?
Mm-hmm. That's it? Oh, piece of cake. Oh.
All done.
All right. Oh, now, seriously.
You're afraid of needles. That wasn't so bad.
No. She's good. Thank you.
Anytime.
All righty. Okay. She has a new job.
All right.
That's it.
You know, it really does strike me that it's such an amazing scientific feat.
Oh, my goodness.
And yet it's such a mundane act.
Right. Yeah. No.
Right? It's a...
Yeah. I mean, that was a piece of cake.
You ready?
I am ready.
All right.
Thank you. I really feel good about today.
Yeah,
I have to tell you.
I feel good. We're making progress to be able to do this at Grady, as we call it, the Grady.
Grady.
Having trained here, it has been one of the highlights of my career to be able to come back here and be a part of this continued advancement at Grady. So I'm really excited to do this.
I, by the way, as a surgeon, I'm also a little bit afraid of needles.
Yeah, and that's scary. Yeah. You're not wincing at all.
Is it in?
It's done.
It's done.
It's done.
You are really good.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah, that's good. That's good.
Thank you very much.
Ooh. Anytime.
All right.
Do you get thanked a lot for jabbing somebody?
I do, actually.
Yeah.
Especially
seriously.
Thank you very much, Mary Catherine.
You're very welcome.
You got any words?
I mean, you know what? As I think about this, I think about how honored I am, right? And I think about the people who several years ago, because you and I know this technology has been worked on for a while, right? This messenger RNA, they just didn't do that at warp speed. There have been people who've been working on this for years, right? And the fact that we see all of this coming together, you think about all the people who did all the animal care facility, people who worked on taking care of the animals when they were doing the preclinical studies. You think about the people who had the idea that you could actually take a genetic code and put it inside of a lipid particle mixing with some salt and create a vaccine. You think about those people. Then you think about the people who are doing the supply chain.
Yeah.
Think about the people in Kalamazoo and the big deal this is for them. I think about the UPS drivers. I think about the people who are flying the planes from who are carrying the vaccine. It's a big deal. And so I'm just honored. And I say thank you to all of those people. Thank you.
And it's important that they be protected as well, because they're often most at risk. John, Erica, I mean, it was a mundane sort of thing to get a shot. I mean, people have seen this so many times, but I got to tell you, I didn't know exactly what to expect. That felt very significant.
Yeah.